Hello, and welcome to today's American Train Co. web conference titled National Electric Code 2014, How the Code Changes Affect Your Facility. During the presentation, all lines will be in a listen-only mode. You may submit a question to our speaker at any time by clicking in the text box at the bottom of your screen. Type in your question, then hit the Send Question button below. Questions will be answered in the order they are received at the end of the presentation. Today's speaker is Bob Clukey. Bob brings over 35 years of practical electrical experience to his students in every class he teaches. Bob has been with American Train Co. since 2007, and in that time, he has become one of the finest instructors we've ever had. Not only is Bob a licensed master electrician, but he is also a certified NCCER and OSHA instructor. In addition, he is a member of the National Fire Protection Association, NFPA, and the International Association of Electrical Inspectors. Thank you for your attention. I would now like to turn the conference over to your speaker, Mr. Bob Clukey.
Thank you, Kellen. I'd like to welcome everybody to this presentation where we're going to make a journey through some of the major changes that have been introduced into the 2014 National Electrical Code. And as Kellen said, here's a little bit of idea about myself. I have been in the trade for a long time. The first National Electrical Code I ever saw was the 1971 version, so I've been around it a bit. I submit a lot of proposals to the National Electrical Code, and I would encourage everybody to be part of that process so that we can improve the document to the best of our ability. So we'll take a look here and a little slide about American Train Co. that we do public seminars and we do on-site seminars. So take a look at these code-wide changes. So these are what the committee calls global changes. So 3,445 proposals, a lot of public comments, and it took the technical committees a little bit of time to work their way through some of these changes. One of the global changes that appears throughout the whole code is 110.21B. It is going to be patterned after the ANSI Z535 standard. So we're going to take a look at that when we get up into Article 110. Another global change, they had 46 proposals to relocate all of the requirements for lockout, tagout into one section. So they put it into 110.25, and we'll take a look at that in particular also when we get up into 110. They also put together a task force to study DC systems. So many solar photovoltaic systems out there now, a lot of work with electric vehicles, and some of which is going to be storing energy back onto the grid. The windmill systems are becoming very prevalent now, so a lot of work was done with the DC side of our industry. Also, a task force was put together to raise the threshold as far as voltage is concerned from 600 volts up to 1,000 volts. And the reason they did that is because there's a lot of DC systems, especially subway systems, that operate between that 600 and 1,000 volt range, and they wanted to make sure they covered that in its entirety with the document. So many changes in the code, it has now gone to 1,000 volts, so that's the demarcation point between low and high voltage now. That's going to present some challenges, especially for the manufacturers. So think of all of the electrical equipment out there that was rated at 600 volts. That is going to have to be resubmitted to underwriters laboratories and now get certified for 1,000 volts. So you can see Cooper Busman has done some, and the cable manufacturer, they've ahead of the game a little bit, so they've got some of their equipment already UL listed at 1,000 volts. And that's a change for all of us, because as long as I can remember, you know, below 600 volts was considered a lower voltage, and above 600 a medium voltage, and now we're going to go to 1,000. Okay, four brand new articles in this 2014 National Electrical Code. So the first one is in Chapter 3, which is wiring methods, and we see Article 393. It is going to be a suspended ceiling system that will conduct electricity. So it's going to be powered by a Class 2 low voltage power system. It's probably going to be around 24 volts. It can be DC. When we get into Chapter 3 and we look at that, we'll give you a little bit better idea on that. My question always comes up is, who's going to install this? Is this going to be the ceiling people, or will the electricians be putting this ceiling grid up? But we'll get better pictures when we get up into wiring methods. Also, another new article is modular data centers. So these data centers are built off-site, and sometimes they're kind of small. Other times they're very large. And we've had in the code for a long time Article 645, which was IT equipment, but the code really wanted to address these modular systems that are becoming much more prevalent than they've ever come before. Another brand new article for us is Article 728, fire-resistive cable systems. And in some of our critical data centers or some of our critical buildings associated with the government, there is a fire rating that does have to be maintained. So they have come up with this cable. That article doesn't have a lot in it at the moment, but they're going to wait for us to go ahead and put some proposals in. So, but you can see the cable is kind of sophisticated in how it's made, and it will withstand a fire. Article 750, the last brand new article, energy management systems, been around for a long time. Finally, the committee has introduced that into Chapter 7 of the National Electrical Code, and we're going to see that impacts even some of the other chapters near the front of that book. But those are the four brand new articles that are in the National Electrical Code, and we'll look at those in more detail as we get up near their sections. Okay, so in definitions, and the technical committee has been playing with this definition now for about three code cycles, and that's fine, but selective coordination, of course, is the overcurrent device that is closest to the fault, is going to be the one that operates first. And you can see in red that they have introduced some new wording here that it's going to be for the full range of available overcurrents, from overload to the maximum available fault current. That's going to present a challenge. It was difficult enough to coordinate those overcurrent devices when we were talking about just fault current. Now we're going to be talking about overloads also. So they wanted to make sure that, you know, it's going to be for every overcurrent that we might see. Another definition is, and they've toyed with this for the past couple code cycles also, is a separately derived system. The most common is, on the left, the transformer. So no direct connection from one source to another source. So the transformer is all inductive. On the right, we see the generator, and when we get up into Article 445 on generators, we will see that the manufacturers of generators are going to have to indicate to us if their generator is a separately derived system, which means that the neutral would be bonded to the generator and its frame. Also, we have to be a little careful looking at the transfer switches there, because to have a separately derived system would have to be a four-pole transfer switch so that we could go ahead and transfer the neutral along with the ungrounded conductors. And that gets us into Article 110 a little bit. So this is 110.16, arc flash warning label. And we are seeing a label right now that the National Electrical Code requires. So when we look at this, we have to understand that the National Electrical Code is an installation document. And there's another label that's talked about in NFPA 70E that deals with operation and maintenance of the electrical equipment. So as we install electrical equipment, we're sure enough going to have this label on there. It can be applied in the field, and it's been that way for about three code cycles now. But also the factory can supply that label. So the manufacturers of the electrical equipment can put this particular label on before it actually leaves their facility. We don't want to be confused between this label, which is sort of a generic label, and it only applies to installation, and that very specific label that NFPA 70E wants us to see. And you can see that they did, in red, highlight the word switchgear. And the reason they did that is they have changed from metal enclosed power switchgear to just the term switchgear. So that had to be taken care of here in 110.16 also. In conjunction with 110.16, and we saw this is a global change earlier on the second slide, I believe, 110.21b. Field applied hazard markings. This is definitely going to coincide with the ANSI standard Z535 for labels. So we can see that this is now talking about any label, field applied hazard markings, not just arc flash hazards. This might be a voltage hazard. It could be any hazard that you might have in your facility. It will have to comply with this section. And one-stop shop is what they'd like to see for all warning labels, consistency, the same font size, the same colors being used, the same wording being used. So try to get some consistency with all these different labels that we have out there. Sometimes I look at electrical equipment and I say to myself, there's so many labels on that piece of equipment that I don't know if I can even get to the equipment. But hopefully this is going to give us a little bit of uniformity, and the ANSI Z535 is definitely what this is based on. So, and there's a new informational note there that does refer us to ANSI Z535. But here's what the gist of the matter is. If we use the word danger, that is going to result in death, and we do have to use a color that's red. So if the word danger is used, then we have to use the color red, no if, and, or but, and it will result in death or serious injury. So we want to understand that is uniform throughout the whole world, really. If we use the color, if we use the word warning, then we're going to have to use the color orange. So, and it could result in death or serious injury. Not that it would. So this is a could statement here. And if we use the word caution, that's going to result in a yellow color, may result in minor or moderate injury. So that all aligns with the ANSI Z535, which is, you know, applied throughout the whole world, not just here in the U.S. This label is the label that NFPA 70E would require. So this is a little above and beyond just that generic label that the codebook applies. But when you put this label on, you do have to be in compliance with that ANSI Z535. I would like to mention at this point that we are going to be receiving a new NFPA 70E, the 2015 version, and that should be available to us in about 4 weeks. The technical committee for that has voted on the final document. They passed it, and it's now gone to the technical writers, and it will be in our hands shortly. So this label complies with 70E, the 2012 version. The 2015 version, there is going to be a little different in this label, where you see 5.5 calories per centimeter squared, and then you see a number 2 PPE level. Those two bits of information will not be allowed on the label at the same time. So you have to make a choice. Do you want to let somebody know what the heat energy is going to be, or do you want to let somebody know what they have to wear to keep themselves safe? But you can't do both of those bits of information cannot be on the same label in about 4 weeks. That's going to occur. And many times that goes back to the software manufacturers that have built the software to put these labels on, so hopefully they have adjusted all their software to take care of that. 110.24, okay, so now we have service equipment in other than a dwelling unit. So your switchgear, any type of service equipment that you might have, main distribution panel, it has to be marked with its short circuit current rating, and that comes out of NFPA 79. So this one, you can see, has 65,000 amps of withstand rating. But we also have to install what the available fault current is. So we have to do that at the time of installation or if the gear is modified. So, and this goes back also to a federal law that our fault current cannot be higher than what the withstand rating is of the equipment. So we better make sure that the short circuit current rating is higher than that fault current, and many different ways to calculate the fault current, but you would definitely need to know the KVA of the transformer and the impedance and the voltage coming into the facility. And then you go ahead and generate that label and get that on your fault current. You got to be very careful that if you do upgrade equipment, you might have to go back and do a little bit more calculation there to make sure that the fault current is still below that short circuit current rating. Lockable disconnecting means. So here we can see that this is going to be talking about lockout tagout. There were 46 proposals to consolidate this into one section, and 110.25 became that section. This is any requirement that we have to have our equipment to be lockable in that open position. There was, in the 2011 code, many different sections required us to do lockout tagout. So now this is going to be a one-stop place. So there were 46 different proposals. They moved them all into 110.25. And now, hopefully, we can go to one place and get some information about lockout tagout. There has been an exception added here for cord and plug connected equipment, so that's a very good thing. But what I do want to mention is this, is that lockable disconnecting means it has to be in place whether you have that lock on that equipment or not. And so you can see here that we do have an exception for cord and plug connected equipment, not be required to remain in place. But if you have a MCC or some type of large piece of equipment, you'll see on this next slide that the piece of metal that is holding the gang lock on there, that is in place all the time. And when we have to lock out, tag out, we're not going to have to use the little red plastic attachments to go over the breaker. We will now have a piece of metal that it, you know, guarantees that we won't have that equipment turned back on. I think that's a great thing that the committee did in that case. Dedicated equipment space. So I'm sure that most of you already know that in front of our electrical equipment, we should have a minimum of 3 feet, and that would be condition one. Condition two, depending on the voltage, would be 3.5, and condition three, depending on the voltage, would be 4 feet. And that space is dedicated to the electrical worker. Well, they have now expanded this a little bit. It's now been expanded to outdoors. So that's going to be a big impact on a lot of our facilities, because when we look at things that are outdoors, we might see a service entrance coming in, and the entrance is actually outdoors, and because it's on the outside of the building, they might want to put some signs up above that service entrance, maybe some advertising signs or whatever that might be. Well, just like it is indoors, we have 6 feet above that equipment dedicated to the electrical installation. So going to have to be very careful. I have seen gutters around that equipment. Can't have that at all. Also got to be careful about other systems. So if they bring in gas piping, you know, telephone, whatever it might be, dish TV, then that space is all now dedicated to us. So here you can see some gas piping coming in, and underneath this meter pack, that's no longer going to be allowed. All this space that's outdoors is now dedicated to just the electrical trade. No other trades can interfere with that space. So that's a big change. We haven't really enforced that outdoors in the past, but looks like it's coming down the road, and we've got to make sure that our buildings are complying with that section. Gets us up into Article 200, which is our grounded conductor. And there are many times when we are wiring with some type of metallic wiring method, pipe, EMT, rigid, IMC, that we have multiple circuits inside that pipe. So there's a requirement now that we have to group that neutral conductor with the associated ungrounded conductors if they are inside the same enclosure. That's a tremendous change. That's going to help us, like we wouldn't believe, as far as troubleshooting is going to go. So all those are coming in a little bit there. If it's obvious what the neutral conductor goes to, then we don't have to worry about grouping it. So if you have a piece of half-inch EMT and there's a black, white, and green in there, that's no problem. We don't have to group any of that. But, you know, most of these neutral conductors are terminated right on a common neutral bar, very difficult to trace. So now we can see in this slide, wherever you have multiple neutral conductors inside a piece of conduit, we're going to have to tie wrap, tape, mark, tag it with a number. Somehow that neutral has to go with the ungrounded conductors that it's associated with. So that's a great thing for anybody that has to try and troubleshoot. Also, in 200.6, the identification for our grounded conductors, they added one little section here for us. Forever, if it's been a size 6 or smaller, it's going to be a continuous white, a continuous gray. They're not going to allow us to identify that in the field. It has to be a continuous. And we could have three continuous white stripes on that conductor. Now they've allowed us to have three continuous gray stripes. So they added the word gray in there, so that's a great thing. If it is a number 4 or larger, we are still allowed to, at the time of installation, to go ahead and identify that conductor in the field. So we can still do that. But also, number 4 or larger, you can see that it says three continuous white or gray stripes on that conductor also. Anybody that is purchasing wire these days knows that the manufacturer has made any size, any color we want. So the matter of re-identifying is becoming a moot point here quickly because the manufacturers have taken care of us a little bit. Excuse me. I did put one slide in that's residential because it's kind of a big impact on the residential market. So arc fault circuit interrupter protection. This is an overcurrent device that will protect your home from any arcs that are behind the wall. So you go to bed at night and you're sleeping and there might be an arc behind the wall. This device is going to take care of us and make sure we wake up in the morning. These have been around since 2002, and now they have added kitchens and laundry areas. So that's a big list of the residential market that we have to go ahead and now have AFCI protection for. And this is going to also include the whole house in 2017. There's really two areas of the house now that are not included, and that would be the garage, and that would also be the bathroom. In 2017, we'll see those two areas come in also. On this code cycle in 2014, they did include the kitchen and laundry areas. So the big question I always get when I show people this is, oh no, Bob, the kitchen is protected by GFCIs. What's going to happen if we have to have AFCI protection there also? Well, the manufacturers have come up with a dual breaker. It does give you both AFCI and GFCI protection at the same time. Or another choice would be an AFCI breaker with a GFCI receptacle. The two technologies are completely different, and they're sensing different, and they're trying to protect different things. The GFCI is protecting people. The AFCI is protecting the branch circuit. So the two technologies, they work fine together and should not be a problem. But that is a big impact. We can see inside this little single-family home that's a lot of AFCIs, and they're not all that cheap. I mean, they're kind of pricey. So, and in 2017, we'll see the garage, and we'll also see the bathroom being included in AFCI protection. Electrical service areas. So now we're talking about your service entrance at your facility, and what they have done is a new provision to require a 125-volt single-phase 15 or 20-amp receptacle installed at that service entrance. And they want to make sure that is there because there is a lot of data logging going on now. And you put that logger on your service, it needs to be able to get power, so they want that receptacle very close to it. They're telling us it can't be more than 50 feet away, so that's fine, but you know, as close as possible would be a great thing. There is an exception for single-family and two-family dwellings. Probably don't have to worry too much about power quality there. But as we can see here, the worker leaning down, he does have a receptacle very close to that service entrance. And wonder if your service entrance is outdoors. Well, we better be putting a receptacle also out there. So, pretty big change. We're going to have that wherever we really need that test equipment. Article 230 is service entrances, and they did give us a list of acceptable underground methods to go ahead and install our service, and they gave us 10. Some of the ones that we've used for a long time are still in there: rigid metal conduit, intermediate, PVC, and you can see they threw in high-density polyethylene, reinforced thermosetting resin. But now we have only 10 methods to go ahead and install that underground service. This is in Article 240, which is overcurrent protection. And in that article, we do have three tap rules. We have the 10-foot, the 25-foot, and the 75-foot tap rule, that if we can satisfy certain conditions, then they're allowing us to install some equipment with no overcurrent protection in it. So they have put an exception in now for surge protective devices at the service that can be tapped off of, let's say, larger conductors with no overcurrent protection. And with the advent of electronic equipment entering our facilities, even our homes, surge protective devices are extremely important in this world. So it was two code cycles ago that they took the TVSS, the transient voltage surge suppressor, and the surge protective device and combined them into one article, and they called it the surge protective device. So this helps against transients, it helps against dips, swells, and it's just going to protect a lot of your electronic equipment. The committee did a great job on that. In Article 250, grounding and bonding, they did make a slight change to grounding electrode connections. And if you look at the right side of this slide, you can see the water pipe is coming into the building a fair distance away from where the service entrance is. So the code committee has allowed us to use that metal steel frame of the building as a bonding conductor. We have to be a little careful of that. We have to make sure that is a metal-to-metal connection all the way back to the service, and because sometimes we're seeing some plastic in there a little bit. But as long as it's metal-to-metal, if the water pipe comes in, we can use the steel frame of the building as a bonding conductor, and that will allow that water pipe, which is one of our best grounding electrodes, as long as it's copper and it's over 10 feet long, that we can go ahead and get that back over to the service without running a wire the length of the building. So, very nice change. Article 300, so now we are in wiring methods, and we are above a suspended ceiling. So, we're looking at a plenum here. The suspended ceiling is using that space up there for return air. The air handler is grabbing it and forcing it down. So, whenever we have that plenum situation, we have to wire with either plenum rated cable or non-metallic, or metallic wiring methods. So now you can see that our tie wraps, our cable ties, they have to be listed. You are listed as having low smoke and heat release properties. So forever, we might have just picked up a clear or white tie wrap, and that tie wrap could have been used indoors. No problem. If we picked up a black tie wrap, that one had UV protection. We could use it outdoors. So now we're going to have another one that we're going to be able to use in plenums. Okay, staying in wiring methods. We can see that we have some covers, and so the cover on the left, the 2014 National Electrical Code, has basically discontinued that cover. All covers now outdoors have to be extra duty and listed for a wet location. And extra duty listing is going to be a heavy metal cover or something much, much better than that bubble cover on the left. Had a lot of problems with bubble covers. They would break. Homeowners wouldn't put them back on. And not just homeowners, small commercial buildings, they would, the receptacle would be out there in the weather, and that was causing a lot of problems. So extra duty and listed for a wet location. And that change applies to every installation we do, from residential to commercial, industrial, wherever we are. Now we need that extra duty heavy cover. Okay, so covers and canopies still up there in Chapter 3. Drywall screws, those are some handy. And you can do a lot of things with a drywall screw. Might want to understand they can't support any weight over 35 pounds, so you get to maybe look at that UL listing of that drywall screw. But now the technical committee has said they're not permitted for us to be able to attach a cover or a device. So no more devices. We have to use the 6/32 screw or whatever it is, 8/32 if we're installing a cover. So it has to be the correct screw and the machine thread for that. Drywall screws, unacceptable to support a light or a device. And so we'll see in this next slide, here's a single pole switch, and they've got that sheetrock screw holding that into that plastic box. Now, to help the inspectors a little bit, the code book has definitely prohibited that from happening. There goes one of our handy little devices that we used to use. Okay, still in wiring methods, and here is our first brand new article. We introduced it to you at the very beginning of the presentation. Low voltage suspended ceiling power distribution systems. This is going to be powered by that Class 2 device. It can either be AC or DC. And it's going to be very similar to track lighting, where we can snap onto that and receive power from that ceiling grid. I'll give you another little picture here. It shows that this one happens to be 24 volts DC. You can see in the bottom left the power supply. You can see in the bottom right there, we can hang fixtures from that ceiling grid, or we can put them right in the ceiling grid themselves like we always have done. But the ceiling grid itself is going to be the wiring method. That is what is going to carry our current for us. And so my personal feeling is that the people that install the ceiling are going to want to continue to install the ceiling, because they're very particular on how that ceiling is laid out and if it's perfectly level or not. And then maybe they'll install that de-energized, and then we'll come in with our Class 2 power supply and go ahead and install the lighting after that. Gets us up into Chapter 4, and we can see in the top right-hand picture that there's a symbol there that we haven't seen much in the past. That symbol is going to have to be installed on any receptacle that is part of a load energy management system. So if you have a load energy management system and you're turning receptacles on and off during the day or at night, then we have to see that new symbol on that particular installation. Also, still in Chapter 4, so, source of supply, non-dwelling units, so this is other than residential. If the panel has more than one source of electrical supply, for instance, we can see here that there's a transfer switch, we can be tied to the utility or to the generator, we now have to put a label on lighting panel A that the optional standby power is supplied from generator 3. So, normal operation, the utility is giving us our power. In the advent that the utility goes out, then of course the generator would kick in, and this label is going to have to be on there, especially important if we are trying to do some troubleshooting or maintenance on that panel when the transfer does occur. So want to know that that label is going to be very important for us out in the field. 4:45, we did mention about generators, and now the manufacturer of the generator is going to have to indicate to us, is that neutral bonded to the frame of the generator? If it is, it becomes a separately derived system. So the manufacturers have already been starting to do this. I've seen them out in the field now. And if we do modify it, we're going to have to go ahead and put the additional marking on there. But this is mostly going to come from the manufacturer of the generator. And, you know, that's just a nice change for us. Now we know if we are separately derived, if we do have a separately derived system, then, of course, we're going to get back to our grounding electrode system. If it's not separately derived, we're just going to ground and bond that piece of equipment like we would any equipment. So here we can see a small generator, 5,000-watt generator, but the neutral is bonded to the frame, so that's great. Because this one is so small and the neutral is bonded to the frame, if we were supplying power with just cord and plug connected equipment, we wouldn't really have to worry about getting to the grounding electrode system. Larger generators, we would definitely have to make that determination, is it separately derived or not, and how are we going to provide a grounding means to keep that generator safe. Okay, and so Article 590. Temporary installation. So now I'm on a construction site, and you can see all these cables just laying on the concrete, and you've got some receptacles there that don't really have the proper covers. So they're telling us now that cable assemblies are prohibited from being installed or laid on the floor during the construction period. So we're going to have to secure those up off the floor, support them, and make it safe for people to walk through that whole construction site. Article 645, so we are up into IT equipment now. And here we can see selective coordination is being addressed again. If that data center is a critical operation data center, it is going to be required to be selectively coordinated. So you can see down below it says any requirement for public safety, emergency management, national security, business continuity, those would all have to be coordinated, and the overcurrent devices would have to match up so that the one that's closest to the equipment would be the first one that's going to clear a fault. Okay, the second new article that we've talked about, modular data centers. These are going to be built off-site. They could be a small piece of equipment like this. They could be very large. All we know is they're built off-site, and then they show up at our facility. So now the National Electrical Code is giving us some guidelines on how we're going to make this installation and have it safe for us. So not a lot in there at the moment, but there will be as we start to submit more and more proposals. 690 is photovoltaic systems. They are becoming extremely prevalent throughout the country. This requirement that we have to de-energize that PV system within 10 seconds in case there is some type of concern there. This is really for the firefighters. So if the firefighters have to come in and try to de-energize a facility, we've got to have that e-stop or that rapid shutdown close to where the firefighters would be. You can see that it's near the service. They're going to be de-energizing the service, but if they de-energize the service, then the array system is not going to be de-energized. So they're doing this with DC relays, and they hit that button. They're going to de-energize the relays and still be some power up on the roof, no doubt about it, but hopefully where the firefighters are, they're going to be safe, and we get that de-energized from any conductors coming back down near the service. Chapter 7 is emergency systems. So many times I think of hospitals. So Article 517 would be associated with this a little bit. It does tell us that a listed surge protected device has to be installed on all emergency system switchboards and panel boards. So you can see underneath the emergency system switchboard there is a listed surge protected device there. And let's just face it, in the hospital there's a lot of electronic equipment, so they want to make sure that that is reliable and going to take care of any patients that might be relying on that. Okay, our third brand new article, Article 728, and the fire resistive cable system. Look at the bottom right where you can see the different layers. And most of this is going to be have a 3-hour fire rating on it. A lot of the critical operation power systems have to have a 3-hour fire rating, so the cable is going to match up with that. This article, as most of the brand new articles, doesn't have a lot in there at the moment, but as long as we go ahead and submit our proposals, then we'll make this article be more user-friendly and give us a little bit more information for us. And the last brand new article, Article 750, Energy Management Systems. And the technical committee felt that these have been around a while. It's time that we get a handle on it and maybe make sure that the installation of these is going to comply with consensus standards. So, brand new article here, Energy Management Systems, and might want to take a look at that if you have one of those in your facility already. Okay, so I did give you my email, so robertjc@americantrainco.com, but now we're going to open this back up to Kellen a little bit and see what we can have for some questions.
Thank you. And at this time, we will begin the question and answer session. To submit a question, click in the text box at the bottom of your screen. Type in your question and then hit the Send Question button below. Questions will be answered in the order they are received. And as a reminder to all participants, we do have the slideshow slides available for download in the text chat box just to the left of the Q&A tab. If you click on that text chat link, it will give you a link to the slides where you can download them for today's presentation.
Okay.
And we do have a question in queue, Bob. I'll go ahead and read this one to you.
Okay.
The question's coming from Ron, and he asks, is OSHA moving away from recognizing 70E as the standard for arc flash?
Okay, that's a great question, Ron. And at the moment, NFPA 70E is a very important part of those OSHA requirements. It's all based on subpart S. OSHA is enforcing that every single day, and OSHA is not going to move away from that. They're going to continue enforcing 70E. It is the consensus standard out in the industry to keep our workers safe. So, of course, all of 70E is based on federal law, so the federal law might be a little bit vague, but 70E is very specific in what we have to do. And you know, we're going to have to live with 70E, I guess, for the rest of our lives, because that is the consensus standard that we do have here in the United States.
Thank you. And I have no further questions in the queue at this time, Bob, but did you have any additional pre-submitted questions that you wanted to address?
I didn't have any pre-submitted questions, so I was just going to wait and see if we had more questions from anybody else on here. It looks like that this recording will also be on YouTube, so if somebody has to go ahead and check and take a look at the information we handled, I guess you could go on YouTube also to take a look at that.
We did have another response come into queue here, Bob. The next response is from Ronald, and he asks, is there a time limit for coordination of protection devices such as 0.1 seconds?
In hospitals, if there's a fault in a hospital, then it has to be coordinated after that fault has occurred for a tenth of a second. But that's the only article that gives us that leeway of having the tenth of a second. In all of our critical operation power systems, it's going to be coordinated immediately. So only hospitals have that tenth of a second requirement.
And as a reminder to participants, feel free to go ahead and submit your questions. We have another question in queue. Can you go over the requirement for labeling ground wiring?
Okay. So, equipment grounding conductors, they can, to begin with, in 250.118 of the National Electrical Code, there's 14 different choices for equipment grounding conductors. So we don't always have to be thinking that it's a wire, because it can be rigid metal conduit, it can be EMT, IMC, many different choices in there for that conductor. Most of us like to rely on a copper conductor, and when we do, that copper conductor can be bare, it can be green, or it can have green with one or more yellow stripes. So if we do choose to use a conductor, then we better make sure that we have green and or green with one or more yellow stripes.
And our next question comes from Peter. He asks, are the new sections definitely to be enforced in 2017?
Okay, so that's a great question. And I want to let Peter know that that is really going to be up to the states when they adopt the National Electrical Code. So I'm going to say at least half of the country has already adopted the 2014 National Electrical Code, so they're being enforced as we speak. But the states are not uniform in their adoption methods, so there are some states that just adopted the 2011 code, and there's other states that might even be lagging a little bit behind that. But whatever the state has for their adoption process, as soon as that is adopted by the state, the whole 2014 will be enforced at that time.
Thank you, Bob. And as a reminder to participants, keep the questions rolling in here. We have an additional one in queue coming from Marshall, and they ask, regarding the demarcation between low and high voltage, am I correct that below 600 voltage is low voltage, 600 to 1,000 voltage is medium voltage, and greater than 1,000 voltage is now high voltage?
No. Okay, so 1,000 volts and below will be considered low voltage. Above 1,000 volts would be medium voltage, and high voltage is going to be above 35,000 volts. So that 1,000 volts and below will now be the standard for our low voltage systems. And we're going to see a lot of especially DC systems that are going to be operating at 625 volts DC, 750 volts DC, and DC technology has really taken off with electronics now. We can transmit DC much further distances than we ever could before. We can combine sources and increase the current. So with electronics, DC has now making a good rise back in our world.
And thank you. We had another one come in. Just one moment, Bob.
Sure.
Okay, and our next question comes from Dan, and he asks, I'm confused about the dedicated equipment space. If it is the width of the electrical equipment, why is the picture shown not acceptable?
Okay. It is the width of the electrical equipment, but it also extends from the floor all the way to 6 feet, I say from the floor because I'm so used to having inside installations, but it would extend from the ground all the way to 6 feet above that equipment. So, and our space is dedicated either the width of the equipment or 30 inches, whichever is larger, but that is going to extend all the way to the ground. So just because we have some equipment above those gas piping, they have still violated our dedicated electrical space right there. And, so we're going to have to be careful outdoors. We put our service entrance in first, and then the gutter people come and they put their gutter system in after. That's going to be a concern. So we're going to have to make sure we design properly, install properly, and make sure it's inspected.
We currently have no additional questions in queue. We'll give participants just a few more minutes here to submit any questions that you may have. Okay, Bob, it does appear we have no further questions or comments at this time. If you'd like to proceed with any concluding remarks.
We'd like to thank everybody for attending today, and also would like to have you become part of the process of submitting proposals to the National Electrical Code. The more public input we have, the better that document will be over time. Make sure that everybody stays safe and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you all for your attention. This concludes today's conference call. All participants may now disconnect.